live in a world where the letter C is a beautiful shade of cerulean blue. The sound of a bass feels like chalk lighting a sidewalk. And the number 9 is a jealous evil wizard who's hopelessly in love with the number 8. My name is Imani Jackson, and this is the world of synesthesia. The neurological phenomenon where two or more senses blend together to create new sensory stimulations. The word synesthesia derives from the Greek word syn, meaning unified or union, and aesthesis, meaning sensation. There are over 80 kinds of synesthesias, and about 1 in 3,000 people experience some form or multiple forms of synesthesia. Some people can hear a sound and taste specific food, while others can feel like they're being touched while watching someone else be touched. Synesthesias can be grouped into two overall categories, projective and associative. Projective synesthesias are synesthesias that affect someone's sense of sight, touch, taste, smell, or hearing. Someone with auditory tactile could feel the sensations of pins and needles in their hand whenever they hear high-pitched sounds, while someone with number form synesthesia sees number sequences as three-dimensional maps in the air around them. These are forms of projective synesthesias. Associative synesthesias, however, are synesthesias where someone's mind associates a connection with a particular object, shape, color, sound, or concept. So, if someone correlates distinct personalities with every day of the week, or if they associate colors with specific music notes, that will be associative synesthesia. It's more common to have associative synesthesias rather than projective. The most common forms are synesthesias that trigger colors, such as color grapheme and chromesthesia, while the rarest are lexical gustatory and mirror touch. Growing up, I assumed that everyone experienced the world this way, and it's so cool knowing that there's a whole world of synesthetes out there, living with the same strange little superpower that I do. I have three types of synesthesia: color grapheme, chromesthesia, and ordinal linguistic personification. Color grapheme synesthesia, a projective synesthesia, allows me to see letters and numbers in specific colors and shades. I discovered that I had color grapheme synesthesia when I was 17 years old while watching an episode of the YouTube show Good Mythical Morning, where Rhett McLaughlin and Link Neal perform weird experiments, try unusual products, and eat non-conventional foods.
Do you have synesthesia, if it please ya?
Does that mean that I can get it if I want it?
No, it just means that that's what rhymed, so I said it.
And I have an easel here.
This is a psychological test placard.
Okay.
Are you ready for test number 1?
I am.
You play along at home. The question is, do you associate numbers and or letters with colors? If you do, this is called grapheme color synesthesia. For example, the number 5 will always be blue.
I remember watching the entirety of that episode and feeling so validated and sort of relieved to know there was a name for this weird little thing that I had, and that others experienced this too. People often ask me how I'm able to read books or take notes or study for tests. The best way to describe it is like this. Imagine you're in a room with bright orange walls. Let's say you get tired of looking at bright orange walls and you decide to paint them black. Of course, you can still see that first layer of black paint, but you can definitely still see the orange paint behind it. That's what it's like whenever I read. I can still see both colors of a letter or number, no matter the color or font that letter or number is printed in. This is what my alphabet looks like with color grapheme synesthesia. And this is what my numbers look like. Everyone with color grapheme sees letters and numbers differently, and it's very rare for two people to see the exact same colors. For instance, while I see A as a soft yellow, someone else could see A as a bright pink or a dark gray. Sometimes the hue of a letter or number will change depending on what other letters or numbers are next to it. Let's use L, for example. By itself, L is a dark bluish green color, like in the word luminous or lipstick. But sometimes, when it's in the beginning of a word, like Liam or let's, it's a bright lime green color. If it's in the middle of a word, like lily or alligator, it becomes a mint green color. Some letters will change their colors completely. D, which is usually a dark evergreen color like in dark or dress, will turn a chestnut brown color in words like candle, reading, and around. As far as I know, there's no rhyme or reason as to why a color of a number or letter changes depending on what's next to it. Growing up, I found that this synesthesia helped me a lot when it came to memorization. In school, I would remember how certain words were spelled by what colors were in the word, or even remembering someone's name by what color their name started with. If I knew the name started with a letter that was a distinct color, let's say yellow, I would go through all the letters that had that same color until I remembered the exact name. Chromesthesia is an associative synesthesia that allows me to see music and sounds as shapes, colors, and textures. During my senior year of high school, I discovered that I had this form of synesthesia. In my AP art class, I was listening to the song Love Triangle from the Broadway musical Paramore, which we had seen on a school trip to New York earlier that year. The opening instrumentals were so beautiful and crisp. I had never seen colors and shapes of a song so vividly and precise before. The violins were sharp, bright turquoise lines, and the bass were curved funnels of cream and bronze. It wasn't until college that I learned that this was called chromesthesia. I find that chromesthesia is one of the most difficult synesthesias to describe, since it happens so quickly and the shapes and colors are so intricate. However, the best way I've seen this synesthesia interpreted is in the 2007 Pixar film Ratatouille. There's a scene where the main character, Remy the Rat, is having an out-of-body experience while eating a strawberry and a piece of cheese. First, he takes a bite of the cheese, and he's surrounded by these soft yellow and orange circular shapes that quickly blip in and out. And then he takes a bite out of the strawberry, and shimmering, vivid magenta squiggles and circles appear. But when he combines the two, it becomes this harmonious blend of red, orange, yellow swirls, and round shapes. While the exact synesthesia that Remy's experiencing is still being debated online, this visualization is eerily similar to chromesthesia. While I listen to songs with vocalists, I've noticed that specific artists have very particular and peculiar associations, usually having to deal with the texture. For example, to me, Nina Simone's voice is like butter spreading on a warm piece of toast. Leslie Odom Jr.'s voice is like a silk ribbon flowing in the wind. Eva Nobelzada's voice is like the fluttering of a bird's wings. Michael Bublé's voice is like the sleek hood of a sports car.
And I'm feeling good.
And Beyoncé's voice is like a smooth stroke of paint. Experiencing all this at once can be overstimulating at times. Another synesthesia that I have that also corresponds with chromesthesia is misophonia, the sensation that causes involuntary and intense emotions to triggering sounds. Some of those triggering sounds include chewing sounds, clicking, water drips, and finger tapping. As someone with misophonia, I sometimes find it difficult to enjoy concerts and live music, ASMR, eating with others, or just any repetitive sound. One of my favorite songs to experience with chromesthesia is a rendition of Candyman by Aloe Black. A few years ago, I found this song after hearing it on an Eminem commercial and immediately fell in love with it.
Need some help, guys?
Yeah.
It has such an array of warm, bright colors and abstract shapes that just pop so beautifully. In the spring of 2021, I attempted to paint how I experienced three specific songs with chromesthesia. The first was Frog by Whirly. The second was Kiss of Fire by Louis Armstrong. And of course, Candyman by Aloe Black. Ordinal linguistic personification is probably the weirdest synesthesia out of the three. This associative synesthesia allows for letters, numbers, months, and even days of the week to have distinct personalities and relationships with each other. I recently discovered that I experienced this in December of 2020 while listening to the audiobook of Synesthesia by neurologist and synesthesia specialist Richard A. Cytowic. I was a few minutes into the book when a certain paragraph really spoke to me. A 7-year-old girl lost her best friend when she told her that the letter A was the most beautiful pink she'd ever seen. "What does your A look like?" she asked. Her friend turned, gave a withering look, and said, "You're weird." After that, the 7-year-old never again spoke of her rich world in which sounds were swirling colored shapes. Words and names had unique taste. And the number 8 was an arrogant, fat lady. At the time, I couldn't believe that this was an actual thing that other people do. I always thought thinking of my letters and numbers as people was just a strange little thing that I did. For me, the letters of the alphabet have the more intricate relationships. First, we have A, B, and C. A is everyone's favorite. The manic pixie dream girl. No one has a bad thing to say about A. Whenever A wants to go on an adventure or has a crazy idea, she always drags along B, her soft-spoken best friend, and C, the tough skater girl. K is a stereotypical cartoon villain. And L is her loyal henchman. K constantly tries to ruin the day of the naive and kind-hearted J, but no matter how hard she tries, K's evil plans never work. When it comes to numbers, 7, 8, 9 have the most memorable relationship. 7, the stereotypical boy next door, has a crush on 8, the punk rock girl, who secretly has a crush on him too. 9, the wizard, is jealous of 7 because he too is in love with 8, and always tries his best to split them up. Saturday is the partier, woo-hoo! And always tries to convince Sunday to go out with him and Friday for a night out. Sunday usually declines and stays home, but he's always ready to take care of Saturday when he returns home, drunk and a mess. November is the most reserved and responsible brother between September, October, and December, and usually takes on the more parental role. He is constantly exhausted by his siblings' eccentric nature and lack of social cues. Similar to color grapheme, rarely do people with OLP associate letters and numbers with the same exact personalities and genders. Some letters or numbers may not even have a gender. Ornolinguistic personification is one of the most difficult synesthesias to research since it's only observable in about 1% of the adult population. Researchers have found that this phenomenon usually begins at a young age and ultimately helps with spelling and memorizing multiplication tables.